Good evening, folks. Thanks for joining us tonight at the first of what we're praying will be an annual event. The Lord has been gracious to us here at Calvary Chapel in Lima and has placed some fabulous brothers in our lives, and they've agreed to be here with us this weekend and share. The theme of what we want you to take away from this conference this year is since we are living in the last days. Not if, but since we are, what should our lives look like as disciples of Jesus? Should that not give us a sense of urgency? Should that not encourage us to cut out all of the political correctness and just be straight with people and say, repent and believe the gospel? Now, these guys that are here, I know that they're all on board with that message. And so you're going to hear a very consistent message this weekend. There are schedules on the front row here. You can grab one if you would like. Tonight, we're going to open up with Michael Boldea. Coach is going to follow him, and then Russ is going to follow them. And Russ, the reason why I put you last is because, the first shall be last, that's right. You went about this same time in Dallas in March, it was 9:30, and the Holy Spirit just fell on that auditorium that we were in, and I don't know, guys, what, 750 people or so? When Russ said, those of you who would like to make a profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and turn your lives over and become a disciple, I want you to stand up in your chair and come forward. And guys, they came in droves, didn't they? And we were up praying. Coach, I know you and Michelle were up. Kathy and I were there, and Pastor Paul was there, and many of the brigade members were there. And I kid you not, folks, Kathy and I had, for a good 15 minutes, at least 10, 12 people in line. And it was that way for 8 to 10 people. People just coming forward to give their lives to Christ, to pray, just to pray for them, to be healed, to be delivered. So it was a fantastic time. And I thought, I'm putting Russ last. So that's the rationale behind that. So we're going to finish up 10-ish tonight, and we're going to start at 9:15 tomorrow with worship, and then we're going to finish up tomorrow 8-ish, something like that. So you know how it goes when you have conferences like this and speakers, and you say, hey, take 45 minutes, and most of the time they take that and then some, and that's fine. That's not a problem. That's why you put a 15-minute break buffer in there. And so if you'd like that schedule, what's up there? Logistics, ladies and men's bathrooms are out this door here. And then there are bathrooms in the basement if you go out and down the steps. That's where the book tables are at, the merchandise from the speakers, T-shirts, and those kinds of things. So if you have any questions about anything this weekend, just stop me and I'd be happy to answer those for you. Also, over on this table, there are some free books. We like giving books away here. And we get a bunch of them because the Lord's blessed us with a radio station. So this little bitty fellowship has a radio station. Isn't that amazing? And guess what? It's not Christian music. Nothing against Christian music. Because I know some people get offended when I get on this rant. But our radio station is a 24/7 Bible teaching station. So we have Bible teachers on there. So we get books all the time. People just send us books, and we love it. So we give them away. We get them free, so we give them to people. So this one's by George Bryson. If you are familiar at all with Calvary Chapels, George, longtime Calvary Chapel guy, back when the Soviet Union fell, and the doors were flung wide open, George spearheaded the Calvary Chapel church planting ministry. And he went in to Russia and trained pastors in Russia to plant churches. And I don't want to misspeak, but I think as a result of his faithfulness to do what the Lord led him to do, there are 80 or so Calvary Chapels in Russia today functioning with Russian pastors. So this book is Grace, God's Riches at Christ's Expense. They're over there, and there's only about 30 of them, so go over there and grab one. Anything else I need to announce, Kathy? Don't think so. Yes, tomorrow we will receive a love offering. This conference is free. You folks are pretty smart, actually, by showing up tonight, because you know where it's at. You know how to park, and there is a parking lot two lots down, so I would encourage some of you to park down there. But folks that are arriving tomorrow, they may or may not get here on time, so you are smart to show up tonight. And a lot of folks, I understand, they can't show up today because they worked and they're driving and all of that stuff. So anyway, we will receive an offering for the speakers to offset the expenses of this, and that's one of the reasons we offer it for free. We don't want it to be at... But if the Lord lays it on your heart to support their ministries, then by all means, please do that. You don't have to wait for the offering. There is an offering box in the back by the sound booth if you want to drop something in there. If you want it to go to a particular speaker or their ministry, please designate that too. Okay? Checks should be made out to Calvary Chapel of Lima. All right? Anything else? I don't think so. Brian's going to lead us in worship. Where is he at? There he is.
Not used to just coming up here cold. Usually everybody's greeting one another in the service. if you would stand with me or sit, whatever you feel comfortable doing. The main thing is we praise.
Rise. For the light has come, darkness bows down to the risen sun, arise, fold your hands and sing to the one God, the one God. You are the matchless king who tore down the gates of the enemy. Make way for Christ and sing. Let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come. Arise, for the battle's won. Our hearts bow down to the risen sun, arise, raise your hands and sing to the one God, you are the matchless king who tore down the gates of the enemy. Make way for Christ and sing. Let your kingdom come. You are the matchless king who tore down the gates of the enemy. Make way for Christ and sing. Let your kingdom come. Come let your light shine in. 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 We'll 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 let your light shine in. Thank you. You are the matchless king who tore down the gates of the enemy. Make way for Christ and sing. Let your kingdom come. You are the matchless king who tore down the gates of the enemy. Make way for Christ and sing. Let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come. Oh, let your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high, and I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. For he is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high, and I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lift your name on high. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, vast, unmeasured, boundless, free, rolling as a mighty ocean in its fullness over me. Underneath me, all around me, is a current of thy love, leading onward, leading homeward to thy glorious rest above. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, spread his praise from shore to shore. How he loveth, ever loveth, changeth never, evermore. How he watches o'er his loved ones, died to call them all his own. How for them he intercedeth, watcheth o'er them from the throne. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, love of every love the best. 'Tis an ocean full of blessing, 'tis a haven giving rest. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, 'tis a heaven of heavens to me, and it lifts me up to glory, for it lifts me up to thee, and it lifts me up to glory, for it lifts me up to thee. Lost are saved, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned, feel no shame at the sound of your great name. Every fear has no place at the sound of your great name. The enemy, he has to leave at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. All the world will praise your great name. the weak find their strength at the sound of your great name. Hungry soul, receive grace at the sound of your great name. The fatherless find their place at the sound of your great name. The sick are healed, the dead are raised at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise your great name. Your great name. Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty. Defender, my Savior, you are my King. Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty. Defender, my Savior, you are my King. Sing the name of Jesus. We worship the name of Jesus. We bow before you, Jesus. There is no other name but Jesus. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise Jesus. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise your great name. Your great name. Your great name. Oh, Jesus, we do praise your great name, and we just thank you for everyone that's here tonight and that's going to attend this weekend. And I just pray that you would just speak through these presenters tonight and tomorrow, and that you just speak to our hearts and would strengthen us and prepare us to go out into all the world and preach the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, well, stay in your spot. Yeah. Thank you, Brian. Our first speaker is Michael Boldea. I met Mike and Daniel in Dallas in March, and I was just blown away by Mike's teaching, and I thought, wow, there's a man that thinks just like I do. That's scary. But the teaching that he presented really resonated with me, and I think a lot of what he had to say was what I had to say later, and will be will be tomorrow even, because I've got this thing that the Lord has in my mind that I need to continue to touch on, and that's being a soldier for the Lord Jesus. So, and I have no idea what you're going to talk about, Mike, but please welcome Michael Boldea.
Now it's on. All right. We should be too. It's good to be here. We drove from early morn, and we made it. And yesterday we spent the day lugging industrial equipment from a now defunct Lutheran college because we're shipping it to our orphanage in Romania. So we're a little tired. But Jesus gives us strength. I thought about this conference a lot over the past few weeks because we understand the times that we're living in, yet other than the urgency, nothing has changed as far as the duty of the believer. See, the only variable that has changed from 2017 and 1922 and, I don't know, 13 AD is the urgency. The stop clock has started ticking. We're winding down. And so I thought, what better way to illustrate what our duty is as believers, especially tonight, than to talk about surfing. As you can tell by my sleek physique and coordination, I am an avid surfer. And I understand there is a huge underground surfing population in Lima as well. but I am going to talk about surfing. And I hope it makes sense to you because it makes sense in my head. This is the way I process. Whatever message God gives me, I have to trust that it makes sense to you as much as it does to me. Throughout the history of the church, there have been those who chase the wave. There have been those who ride the wave, and then there have been those who are the wave. And unfortunately, in our day and age, there are a lot more wave chasers than there are waves. The children of God are called to be forces of nature. The children of God are called to be waves. We are not called to be wave chasers. We're not even called to be wave riders. And we see an example of this clearly in the Word of God. We see both the wave chaser and we see the wave riders, and then we see the waves. And the waves are undeniable. You can't turn your eyes from them. Because when they make an impact, it's felt throughout. I was reading this tonight. We got in about an hour and a half ago now. Whenever I leave a place, whenever I get to a place, I crack open my Bible and I read, and that's the way I work. And I opened up to Acts chapter 8. And herein we see an example, the perfect example, of a wave chaser. Saul began to persecute the church. The church was scattered throughout. A man named Philip went to Samaria. And he preached Christ to them. Great revival broke out, so much so that he called in reinforcements. Peter came along, and in the city of Samaria, there was a sorcerer, a man who did tricks. And when he saw what was happening, and when he saw what the power of the Holy Spirit could do, and when he saw just how minute his presence was compared to the presence of the Holy Spirit, the first thing that went through his mind is, hey, I can make a buck off this. Honestly, this is what he thought. Chapter 8, verse 17. Then they laid hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Now when Simon, the aforementioned sorcerer, saw that through the laying on of hands of the apostles the Holy Spirit was given, he offered them money, saying, "Give me this power also, that anyone whom I lay hands on may receive the Holy Spirit." His words were noble, his intents were not. Peter had discernment. Peter's discernment said, "Nay, nay, because your intent is not pure. You are a wave chaser." And we've seen the progression of wave chasers in today's modern church. And the only problem with wave chasers is that they become carbon copies of each other. Now, I know that those of you that are under 30 have no clue what carbon paper is. But back in the olden days, there was this like blue sheet of paper that you used to put between two white sheets of paper, and then you used to press your pen down really hard, and it used to make a carbon copy. But it didn't turn out quite as good as the original. Now, if you needed three copies, another sheet of carbon paper, another sheet of white paper, and eventually, if you went down low enough, guess what? It was just a blur. There was nothing there. See, carbon copies are a sure descent into mediocrity. And I'm sad to say it because I love the body of Christ. I'm sad to say it because I love the church, but we've descended into mediocrity. We do not aspire to the waves in God's house. We aspire to the wave chasers. We aspire to the Simons of how can I monetize this? How can I get mine? How can I make a few bucks? And if that enters your mind, you will tweak the message so that your end goal is achieved. Stuff, things. And one carbon copy becomes fuzzier than the other, and then you end up with your best life now. This is the reality that we're living, because we have a prototype of what the church should be in the book. See, this is an amazing, amazing thing. You crack it open, you see what the church ought to be, and then when you compare it to what the church is, you see all the areas where the church is lacking. And it's very scary. Because every single area that the church is lacking is what the church needs in order to combat the enemy. Do you understand this? We are powerless against an aggressive foe because we have become content with wave chasers in the church. What's the next big thing? What was it? What? 10 years ago, you saw one guy with skinny jeans and horn-rimmed glasses. Now, throw a stone, you'll hit 15 pastors that are dressed the same way, speaking the same message. Next week, we begin a foray into financial independence. 17 weeks of how you can save the Jesus way. Noble. But what does that have to do with your spiritual man? What does that have to do with your spiritual well-being? What does that have to do with the Holy Spirit indwelling in you? What does that have to do with the gift of the Holy Spirit acting uniform in the church so that the church might be something useful for the kingdom of God? And not just a place that collects 10% of your income. But see, we acquiesce to these kinds of things because we live in an age where we despise the notion of being challenged. We feel as though we're entitled to all of God's best. And somehow we define God's best as stuff. A nice house, a nice car, maybe a boat. Some of the brand name wave chasers, private jets. And this is what they equate with God's best. But see, there's a marked difference between the world's best and God's best. And God's best is here while the world's best is here. And today's church aspires to the world's best. While God says, stop looking down at the scraps. Stop looking down at the scraps. All these things that these vile men on television tell you, you should be wanting. The bigger, the better. These are scraps compared to what God has for you. How can a McMansion compare with joy in tribulation? I'm not talking about plastering on a fake smile. I'm talking about feeling joy in the innermost being of you. When you're going through the most difficult time of your life, when everyone around you going, I think you've lost your mind. How can you be smiling? Because Jesus is in me. Because I have his best, and I know that my Redeemer lives, and I know that whether today or 10 years from now, I will stand before him and he will say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. No, but you want a private jet. Can't fly a commercial. Too many demons. If you don't know, look it up. It's true. These are our spiritual betters. And they're nothing more than wave chasers. Then you have the wave riders. Those are a little smarter than the wave chasers because they see the wave coming in the distance and they start to paddle. You know how it is? I've never surfed a day in my life. I'm sorry. If you can't tell, I tell the truth. I've never surfed a day in my life, but I've seen it done. And the smart ones, when they see a wave coming, they start to paddle a little bit in front of the wave so that the wave begins to carry them. But see, the wave riders are more style than substance. It's about the packaging, not the contents. And so you could sit there and listen to an hour and a half teaching on absolutely nothing, but because they speak with inflection, you think they're sowing into your life. And I've had arguments with people over this. Why do you bash Brother Joel? Because he's a fool. I'm hard-pressed to call him brother. Because if he were a brother, he'd serve the same master and he'd speak of the same God. And he'd read from the same Bible and he'd teach about the same Christ. And he wouldn't be an apologist for sin. Amen. Because he'd be honest enough with those who were listening to him to say, sin is death. I don't want you to die. I could care less about your best life now. My only concern is your life then. That instant, that moment, you stand before him. But I got a signed copy. Good kindling. Look, we need to start seeing everything that we allow into our hearts through the prism of the Word. Because if we don't, we're in for a bumpy ride. And see, although the wave riders are a step above the wave chasers, a wave rider can just stop surfing the wave at any moment. When it gets a little turbulent, when it gets a little rough, when they think they can't hold their balance, you've seen a, they just veer off because they don't want to risk hurting themselves. See, the wave riders of today are the good time preachers that we see littering the landscape. They're the ones that like the perks of being shepherds, but they'll run away at the first sign of wolves. The first time they have to fight off a wolf, the wave riders will run away. And I've had to deal with more people than I want to think about that have gone to the brink of brokenness because their shepherd ran away from the wolf instead of fighting it off. Because their shepherd was a wave rider. While he could stand on the board, while he could make a little scratch, while life was good and everybody called him pastor and invited him down to the Golden Corral or the Ponderosa, things were good. He had respect. But see, when it started getting rough, this is not what I signed up for. And then you have the waves. It's not one wave, because wave calls upon wave. See, this is the beauty of the household of faith. This is the beauty of God's ingenious plan for his people. He didn't put it all on the shoulders of one man. Wave calls upon wave. And the longer it takes to form, the greater impact when it hits land. So let's discuss waves. I know. Fascinating, isn't it? A wave is immutable in its purpose. That's the first thing you need to take away from tonight, as far as my talk is concerned. Because Coach is going to get up here and he's going to yell at you. See, Coach is a wave in his own right, because no wave is the same. Some waves are bigger, some waves are smaller. Some waves crash loudly. Others whisper. But they're waves all the more. So the first thing you need to understand about a wave is that it is immutable in its purpose. It knows what it needs to do, and nothing will dissuade it. Have you ever been to the ocean and stood in front of a wave? Does it stop in front of you because you're standing there? No. It washes over you and it keeps going. Its purpose is singular. It is immutable in its purpose. A wave is also immutable in its direction. Forward. It doesn't matter what the obstacle before you is. Forward. It doesn't matter how many levees are put up before you. Forward. It doesn't matter how many people don't want you to make it to land. Forward. That's it. It's like a car with only no reverse. Forward. Because if we begin to retreat at the first sign of opposition, if we begin to retreat every time the enemy gets angry, if we begin to retreat every time we get a little hate mail, ha, you should see my inbox, then we're of no use to the kingdom of God. You need to understand that if you speak the truth, you will have enemies. Get used to it. Don't try to circumvent it. Get used to it. When the enemy roars like a lion, you know that you're intimidating him. See, it's when the enemy leaves you alone that you should be concerned. But a lot of believers are very happy in that passive state. Ooh, yeah. Enemy's leaving me alone. I better sit here quietly and go like this. I don't want him to attack me. Why? You have the armies of heaven behind you. You have your general standing with you. Why wouldn't you want your enemy to attack? He deserves a good whooping once in a while. But see, it's because we never stand our ground that we don't see the victory. See, if the church would start standing its ground a little more, we would see more of the power of God in the church. We would see more true victories, demonstrable, not victories in our own minds. Well, you know, I ran away from the enemy, but I jogged. I didn't full sprint, so that's a win. No, it's not. You still ran. Don't try to justify it in your head. You know a victory when there's a victory. When the enemy is felled, that is a victory. Amen. That's it. Not when you try to come to agreements with the enemy. Well, you know, you take this side, I'll take this side. We'll have a gentleman's agreement. Enemy's no gentleman. Sorry. He will always go back on any agreement that he makes with you. And this is another thing the church seems not to understand. We think we've called a truce with the darkness. You can come right up to the front steps, but not in. Doesn't work that way. You give the enemy a finger, he'll take a hand. You give him a hand, he'll take an arm. You give him an arm, he'll take your torso. Because the enemy is never content unless he has total victory. And this is why there is no such thing as a truce with the enemy. It's darkness and light, that's it. One must overcome. It's incumbent upon you to do what is right for the light to overcome and not the darkness. Amen? A wave is also immutable in its objective. It knows what it needs to do, and it follows through. Doesn't matter if it's hard. It doesn't matter how long it takes. It does what it needs to do. We can't shy away from hard work. Because I know it's the same people that say marriage isn't work that say Christianity isn't work. Both are work. I've been married 17 years. Marriage is work. I'm married to an Eastern European, so you have to allow me that. But marriage is work. A good marriage is work. A good Christian takes work too. Because a good Christian is perpetually standing before God and saying, Lord, what would you have me chisel away today? Hallelujah. See, a good Christian is continually perfected into the image of Christ. He doesn't say, I made it. Now what? He's humble enough to acknowledge the fact that every day he needs Jesus. It's not a one-time encounter. It's not something you do on a Sunday morning when you were too bored and, oh, all right, I did it. Because I've seen a lot of those commitments. Glory, 17,000 new believers. How many showed up the next week? Well, none, but there was a baseball game. It takes more than going like this in a crusade or a church. I'm sorry. It takes the knowledge of the Word of God. It takes the knowledge of Christ in your life. It takes the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. There is so much to being a true believer. But once you come to that place where you understand the fullness of God, you walk in the authority thereof. And then you are a force of nature. A wave does not consider what comes after. It doesn't. Its purpose is singular, to crash against the rocks. It doesn't consider what comes after. It doesn't consider its reputation. It doesn't consider its legacy. It doesn't consider itself. It doesn't consider its retirement. And too many, especially those that have achieved a certain level of fame within Christendom, would rather protect their reputation than defend the name of Christ. And the disgusting thing is that they would rather protect their reputation before the world. I know, it hurts. I'm right there with you, but it is the truth. If I have an opportunity to preach Christ, and instead of preaching Christ, I defend my own reputation, I'm sorry, I'm not worthy of the name Christ. Let's be clear about that. We need to stop with this. Well, you know, you eat the meat and spit out the bones. Well, I have another analogy. Don't drink poison, it kills you. Right. See, far too many today are concerned with their own little piece of the pie. I need to grow my ministry. Well, if it's your ministry, then we're in trouble. If it's not God's, then it's built upon a man. And anything that's built upon a man comes crashing to the ground sooner or later. And you see it. You hear about it. And it breaks your heart every time. Pastor so-and-so caught in a prostitution sting. Pastor so-and-so overdosed in a hotel room in Atlanta. And you're like, ow. Pastor so-and-so shot himself in the face in front of his church, in the parking lot. These are supposed to be the spiritual leaders of our time. And if the head is this rotten, I what can you say about the body? See, this is why we need to get serious. Because this isn't just practicing surfing. This is an actual competition now. The stopwatch has started, and we're seeing all the pieces moving into place, and we're still woefully unprepared as a church. We're still woefully distracted by the things of this earth. And I fear that we're running out of time. Now, one of the greatest waves in the Word of God was a man by the name of John the Baptizer. We all know him as John the Baptist, but he was actually John the Baptizer. He wasn't really a Baptist. I know, blows your mind. I had an argument with somebody over that once, believe it or not. Because everyone's a theologian now. You have Google. So go with me to Matthew chapter 3. And let's see what a wave looks like. In those days, beginning with verse 1, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." So, John the Baptist came preaching where? In the wilderness of Judea. He didn't go to the front of the temple and go, "Let me in. I have a message. I have a message for you." He went to the wilderness, the most unexpected place, and he began to preach a message that would turn 99% of people off today, because it wasn't a message of prosperity. Amen. It wasn't a message of self-actualization, of feeling better about you. It was a message of repentance, of taking all those things that your flesh really loves and nailing them to a cross and turning your back on them and saying, "He is worth more than them."
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
And if you want to hear a real tragedy, it's that many of today's Christians prefer their sin rather than God, and this is why the church is in the state that it's in. If you don't believe me, look around. Because the message has been clear for 2,000 years. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. But see, the wave chasers and the wave riders saw a market niche. That's what it was. All right, there's not a lot of people that respond to this repentance thing. What can we do to fill auditoriums of tens of thousands of people, make bunches of money, and be treated as intellectuals that we are not, is basically what they did. And so it was ingenious. They handed out cards and they say, "You tell us what you'd like to hear preached in church." It's like me going to a doctor and the doctor saying to me, "You tell me the diagnosis you want me to give you." "Eat more bacon." "All right." It's the same concept. If I go to church and I dictate to the shepherd what I want to hear preached, it's no different than me going to a doctor and telling the doctor, "This is what I want you to say my diagnosis is." Now, I look in the mirror. I know me. If I went to a doctor, I know what he'd likely tell me. "Stop eating, fatty. Lose some weight." I get it. That's why I don't go to doctors. And see, most people who walk through the doors of certain churches know what they should be hearing, because they have at least a tangential relationship with this book, and they've read it over and over again. Okay, this John guy said repent. Jesus said repent. Peter said repent. Luke said repent. Who didn't? Well, Paul said repent. There's a lot of guys that said repent. All right, but I don't want to do that. So where are we going to go? Howdy, y'all. Jesus loves you. Now, sin is not God's best, but there's no but. Sin is death. Let's be honest. Sin is death. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This was the message of John the Baptist, or the baptizer. And he was out in the desert preaching this. Now, the amazing thing is this. Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region around the Jordan went out to him. John didn't chase. John didn't ride. John was. And people came to see the wave because they heard the roar of it. It was undeniable. And if you see the portrait of John the Baptist, he was so unconventional. He wasn't there in priestly robes. Come hither, my children. It says the man clothed himself in camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. And he ate locusts and wild honey. So imagine that. A man in the wilderness eating locusts and wild honey, dressed in a camel hair coat, screaming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And the amazing thing was, people flocked. They came to get baptized because they couldn't help but heed the call of the wave. On every level, except one, John the Baptist was very irreverent. He was irreverent of the power structure of his time. He was irreverent of the religious structure of his time. But see, a lot of people conflate his irreverence and say, well, he was irreverent of God, so we can say whatever we want in church. No, he wasn't. John was never irreverent of God. He was irreverent of fools, but he was never irreverent of God because he preached the word. He preached repentance. And it was a very simple message. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to his baptism, John said, "I've made it! They love me! I've seen a lot of young men full of zeal who preached truth, who got turned upside down and inside out the first time they ever got a TV interview. I made it." What did John say? Hey, guys, welcome, welcome. Lord bless you. Lord bless you. Come get baptized. Hey, maybe I can come preach for you guys if you go on vacation sometime. You know, maybe we can coordinate, network. Let's network. I'll give you a business card. You give me one of my, it'll be great. Brood of vipers. Who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Wave. Unconcerned about his reputation or legacy or, am I going to offend this person? You know, they're somebody powerful. They know somebody who knows somebody who works for the 700 Club. I can't tell them to stop sinning. I could get on the 700 Club if they like me. I've been on it. Not that special. Unconventional, counterculture, and fearless. Do not attempt to be a carbon copy of somebody else. Do not attempt to chase after what somebody else is doing in the hopes that you'll become famous by osmosis or whatever it is. Surrender your life to God. Be willing to be broken on the rocks and have no other desire beyond that to fulfill the function of a wave. And then you will know freedom. People think I'm insane. They do. I've met somebody who says, "Brother, I love you, but I think sometimes you're mad." And, well, thank you. Because I'm unconcerned with myself. I'm unconcerned with my reputation. Because it's not about me. John didn't come to start his own denomination. He wasn't baptizing people so he can start his own niche church. He was a forerunner to Christ. You are an ambassador of the kingdom of God. Act like it. It's not about you. See, because there have been some people who were ambassadors to nations and then they started feeding information to the other nation. What was it? Treason? Is that what it's called? Russians! The Russians! No, we are on enemy ground. This is enemy territory. Make no mistake about it. And your duty is to be a light in the darkness. Your duty is to be a wave, to be a force of nature, unstoppable, immutable. And you should know your purpose already. And you should know the why of why you do what you do. And if the word I is anywhere in that, it needs to get crossed out, axed out, cut out. Because it's not about I or me or flesh. See, this is one of the most detrimental things to happen to the church in the last 100 years. We started making it about us. It's all about you. No, it's not. I'm sorry, you're not that special. Neither am I. Well, brother, but I feel, who cares? Feelings have no place when it comes to this. Feelings are not arguments. They're not proof. They're not the word. So the next time you hear someone, well, I feel, I don't care. Show it to me in the book. If it's in the book, we'll discuss. If it's not in the book, then don't even try with the feeling thing. Because feelings brought us to this place. Feelings brought us to this absolute farcical idiocy that's happening in this nation especially, but throughout the world. Where a boy is a girl is a boy isn't a girl, but you call me a girl if I'm a boy. Oh, what? This is happening. And there's churches going along with it. Yep. Hey, so much for science. You know, X chromosome, Y chromosome. It's simple. But see, we've allowed the foolish things of this world to complicate simplicity. The wave doesn't care. It just rolls. And wave calls upon wave. And another one crashes, and another one crashes. And you know what? It may take a year or 10 years, but eventually you start to erode. It starts, there's progress. You can see it. Slowly but surely, the waves are making progress. And this is the thing that should be encouraging to you. It takes longer than being bombastic. It takes longer than fireworks and flashlights and smog machines. But the waves are having an impact. And every single week I get letters and emails from young people who are going, man, I've been going to a church that's been feeding me nothing but nonsense. And I found your radio program, like, somebody's actually saying something that's worth listening to. Because I don't ride a wave. It's not about style. It's about substance. Be substantive. You don't have to be the most eloquent. You don't have to be the wittiest. You don't have to possess the biggest vocabulary. But be sincerely in love with Christ. And it will show. Be sincerely in love with Christ, and the words you speak will be more than the substance of the words you speak, if that makes sense.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Because if the Spirit of God dwells in you, then every word that comes out of your mouth that is inspired by the Holy Spirit is turbocharged.
Yeah.
And it pierces the heart, and it pierces the heart. And that person may be driving down the road an hour hence and going, wow.
Hallelujah.
It's like somebody slapped him across the face.
Thank you.
But in order for that to occur in your life, you can't chase waves and you can't ride waves. You have to be fully committed to it. You have to be a wave.
Amen.
And we saw a great example of a true wave.
Thank you.
John the Baptist was a wave.
Hallelujah.
Probably not the most handsome man. If you spend your days in the desert in a camel hair coat, probably didn't smell like Chanel No. 5. I'm guessing. But that didn't matter, because the man was a wave. And the sound of him drew those from Judea and drew those from Jerusalem, and they came. He didn't chase after them. They came to him. And even the Pharisees, the religious leaders, the wise men among them, they came to be baptized. And rather than be flattered, and rather than go, oh my, well, welcome, gentlemen. He called them a brood of vipers. I'm going to have good conversation with John the Baptist when I get to heaven. He's my kind of guy. So over the course of these 2 days, you're going to hear from such men. And by that, I don't mean that they smell. But they are waves in their own right. They are men who are fearless. And they're men who are determined. And they're men who understand the objective. Because it's not about now. Now is fleeting. This is ending. Everything that you see, I know that we think that we've bought ourselves time. We haven't. It's all coming to a head, because the Word of God doesn't lie. And we can hear the seconds ticking by. And I, for one, don't want to live with the regret of what could have been, if only. It's a horrible position to be in. What could have been, if only? If only I decided to be the wave rather than the chaser. What could have been if only I decided to stand in the gap rather than wait for somebody else to take my place? What could have been if I'd actually decided to step out on the battlefield rather than be a spectator and judge all the other ones on the battlefield? I don't want to live with that. I'd rather do my part for the kingdom, because I know that my master greatly rewards faithfulness. And that always brings a smile to my face. Thank you, and God bless you. Amen.